rather than I'm just giving a lecture, right, that we can make it as interactive. So an introduction about me, myself, Sachit Ainikal, and this is my career path. So I started as a developer and was privileged to work on some interesting technologies, Java, you all know. So I was with Sun and Oracle for quite a long time, and now works with Pivotal, looking after all the technical engagements in India, part of APJ team. So basically what we do is that we go and meet all these customers and talk to them about what is happening in this industry, right? The containers, then you will be having all this cloud orchestration, all this new technology. So we basically talk to the customers, help them to adopt this, and you know, make them to transform. So that's what we do as Pivotal. But you know, before that, let me ask one simple question. How many of you in the room worked on Cloud Foundry? Raise the hands, please, if you worked on Cloud Foundry. Okay. Okay. Nobody has worked. How many of you are a developer? Most of them are developer. Anybody works on the operation side, like managing the containers or the VMs, try to deploy the things?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Very good. Okay, okay. So how many of you really worked on cloud? So that's some cloud, right? Okay. Anybody not even worked on Docker, the first time coming for this conference, wants to learn more, feel free, no problem. Okay. I was also like you probably 2-3 years back. So very good, very good. Okay. So let's take this approach. So we have a mixed crowd. What do you see here, right? It is like how a car is manufactured. There are two, you know, extremes. The black and white picture, you are seeing how the Ford, you know, started to manufacture the car, how it is transformed today. So bring this concept, just bring it into your mind. We are all seeing how the IT industry is transforming. So this is my 18th year in the industry, I'm sure. So few of you maybe, you know, 5, 10, 15, 20. We are all going through various changes. If you bring that example to the IT industry, at least some of you are familiar with this, if not all. Traditionally, even today, most of the companies in India, so we do this. If you have a product, right, you are all on the development. What is the, you know, typical life cycle of a project? Anybody? 3 months, 6 months, 1 year? 6 months to 1 year? But what is it? Today, 9 a.m. in the morning is running in production. This is not the Pivotal talk. And that example I have given, it's not, I'm not sure whether they're a Pivotal customer or not. That's a different thing. This is on the public internet. You can go to that Wellsworks Engineering, so that is a national domain company. They push code in every now and then. I just checking, they push their code at 9:52 a.m. today into a production server. The developer is working, just pushing the code into the production server. This is happening. Look it into Amazon. Look it into Twitter, Google. This is happening. So, what am I trying to say here? IT industry landscape is changed. That is why you are all here, wants to learn about containers, Docker, and all those things. I'm sure many of you are familiar with at least some of these terms. All of you heard about continuous integration and delivery. Anybody doesn't understand that? I don't need to explain that, right? Okay, you understand that. 12-factor applications. People heard about it. I'll talk about that slightly. But this is the reality. Any Java programmers in the room? Have you heard about Spring Boot? Some of them, right? So Spring Boot is, again, it's a Pivotal product. We just launched it in 2014. Can somebody give an example or a definition of DevOps? What is DevOps? Anybody? We all hear this, right? DevOps, we need DevOps engineers. What is DevOps?
I would say enabler.
Sorry?
DevOps is an enabler, right? Can
correct.
Enable a developer to reach production fastest possible.
You're right. So that's all connected with the continuous integration delivery and all those things, right? That's what to achieve that. So anybody heard about Netflix Oasis? If you are a developer, I encourage go and read about it. So this is about how Netflix is delivering all their applications. People are familiar with Netflix, right? All of you heard about Netflix, right? And they even recently started the operations in India. You just go and stream it. Now it's even the, you know, the Netflix is 1 month free offer is there. I was just a subscriber there, you know, Krishna was telling me I do the babysitting, right? I was just trying to find ways to engage my kids. I realized Netflix is free, yay, 1 month. Just stream it, you know, amazing content out there. But have you ever thought of how are they doing that? So when Netflix transformed, right, they implemented an entire set of software infrastructure on top of Amazon. This entire suite of products, they open source. That's known as Netflix Oasis. Many companies tries to adopt this Netflix Oasis as part of their product development. This is all on open source. So these things basically transforming how the people are writing software today. But coming back, this is a glimpse, just see the glimpse of that slide, right? We'll come back. So the point is, it's all about containers. So, can somebody tell, you heard the keynote and all those things, why containers? Sorry? You can repeat it, okay? Okay?
Faster.
Okay? Okay, that's all? Repeat what?
Ready to ship.
Portability. Okay.
Okay.
Don't record. Yes. I agree. Yes. Other than that. Yes. Correct. So, okay. So, all of you are given, you know, the correct answers, right? So, 2015 December, there was a survey, and the survey results are there in the screen. It's coming up, right? The people said that I go for containers for faster, easier deployment. Then, flexibility in deployment. Then, another thing, isolation, right? I'm getting better isolation. Other thing is that, yes, people want to adopt this microservices, cloud native, and all those things are there. So there are various people who try to evaluate containers. There are various reasons. And it doesn't stop there. This was in 2015 December. But when people adopt the containers, what is currently happening is, yes, I have all these tools. I have Docker, Compose, and all those tools are there. You know, I'm a developer. Yes, I know how to write code in Java. I know how to write it in Python and all those things. I will do that. But I'm sure you people are doing this. What is this? I'm having a container. That container is running on top of a VM, nothing more than that. Yes or no? How do you take it into production? Have you ever thought about it? When you write an application, right? End of the day, that application has to run it in production. That's all purpose. I know customers, even in India, well-known names. They are all adopted Docker. But they are running this way. So what are you saving? Nothing. So containers will bring cost savings if you run multiple containers on a VM. Why they are not able to run that? Because just the container is not sufficient. You need lot and lot of tools around it. You need to have containers, you know, interacting with each other. When you want to scale it up, right? So scalability is another aspect. Why people are going for containers and these microservices? You need to scale it up. That's the problem. And eventually, most of the time when people run containers in production, this is what happening. This we are really seeing that. See, I'm telling that when we talk to the customers and we are realizing that customers are sitting in a queue. So this is a reality. What this picture shows, if you're not running the containers in proper manner, or any container is not sufficient. End of the day, what is a container? The container is nothing but, it is just, you know, similar to your virtual machine, but with the limited, what you can say, the functionalities and all, the bare minimum things to run your application. It is having the same Linux kernel environment, okay? So it is having the bounded context. It's just good enough to run your application. That's all. So the point is, if you bring multiple containers in production, you need somebody to basically run these containers. That is where all this Kubernetes aspect comes. Okay, you need, and of course, Kubernetes is not only the one tool there, there are multiple tools there. If you look at it into the Docker, right, first the Docker came up with the Docker Swarm. Then there was a, you know, now Docker Data Center. There are multiple tools are coming up. Typically, this is what happens. We are all developers, that's why I asked how many of you are developers. As a developer, we would love to say that I wrote my application, everything works fine, I hand it out to the whoever it is, it's their headache now. So that is exactly why the DevOps, I was asking you, why the DevOps, why companies are forming a DevOps team, right? Because there is a lot of cultural mismatch, expectation mismatch, and the tools they are operating, it's all different. And if you analyze it in deeper, right, basically this is what happens.
It's a, you know, collection of all those things required if somebody
wants to move an application to the cloud. Point is, whether it is a container, it's a Docker, it's a microservices, DevOps, all those things, the whole motive of this is adopting this cloud native. And when we talk about the cloud native, I have so many slides. It's all one step backward, right? Why this guy is coming and standing and talking all those things, right? This is what typically we talk to the customers. Think about a scenario earlier when you were developing, you were just having infrastructure as a service. My friend was talking about the virtualization. So now virtualization is moved, infrastructure as a service. That is the typically we known as IaaS. So then we are all familiar with something called container as a service. So basically, what is Docker? Docker is nothing but a container. If a platform gives you a flexible way to run this Docker in production or in your development cycle, that is nothing but it's a container as a service. Hey, I want to develop a program using Docker. Somebody has to run it, right? So this is where the Docker data center, Kubernetes and all comes. So this is a container as a service. There is a next level, this is a platform as a service. That is where the Cloud Foundry and OpenShift and all this, you know, the platforms, you know, really evolved in the last 2-3 years. Because you can see the abstractions, right? That's why the picture talks a lot. What is the difference? In the containers, again, you are responsible to make the container and fix the things inside the containers. Whereas in the past, the platform offers to you everything. You have to just worry about your applications and bring your data sets. But it doesn't stop there. So now everybody talks about the function as a service. Might have heard about Amazon Lambda. Then IBM has OpenWhisk. Right? What is happening? You write the code, you give to the platform, you don't care how the platform is going to run that. This is the concept of the function as a service. So when we talk about the cloud native platform, right? We believe that a platform basically do all these aspects and just help the developer to do whatever they love. They have to just write the code. The platform should do all those things. Why I am telling this? Typically, you know, what we have seen is that any platform, right? I was talking about how the Netflix created Netflix OS. All those things are evolved like this. Yes, I am experimenting with something, new technology, Docker or whatever it is. Then, okay, I will try to write some script around it, okay? Then, okay, then slowly that application is building. If you just close your eyes and reflect, this is the mess in most of the industries, most of the enterprises, multiple teams, silos, and all those things. If you ask what is Cloud Foundry, this is a very opinionated, very structured platform. It does, I won't say 90% or 100%, but it does at least 70 to 75% of what you have seen in the previous slide with the multiple things in a very structured manner. So as I said, it's a very structured platform. It's abstract, a lot of things. It brings the container orchestration. It brings a cloud API, which already implemented and supported by Pivotal and open source community across your cloud. So the point is, you don't need to worry, how am I going to deploy it? Even you can deploy a Docker container. Even you can deploy a .NET. You write a .NET application, give to Cloud Foundry, it will run it on the containers for you. Write a Java application, push it into Cloud Foundry. Write a PHP application, push it into Cloud Foundry. Nothing else you need to do. So basically everything to deploy and manage the apps, it's already pre-built into that. So that way, I don't have the slide. So in a high level, if you look it into that, you have the Docker containers, Docker Compose, you have Kubernetes, you have underlying VMs, all those things, right? If somebody tried to stitch it together and give it to you, that's exactly what Cloud Foundry is. And for developers as well as operators, right, there is a well laid off, user interfaces. So operating and adopting, this is, it's very simple. And basically the platform brings a lot of automations. You don't need many people to, manage the platform. So that is where it helps the enterprises to really, adopt this concept, right? You have an idea, quickly deploy into production. If you want to do the continuous integration and delivery, this will be your deployment target. How do you do that? I'll just show that. And this is very important. I'm sure you people know about the disaster recovery. When my application goes down, I need, some other setup has to come up. But in the Cloud Foundry, you can do it in 4 levels. No other platform can do it today. If your specific application Java process goes down, the platform automatically detects and brings it up. If your container process goes down or something happens, it slows down, Cloud Foundry will spawn another instance. Assume that your VM goes down, the Bosch underneath will bring it up. You have multiple racks and define it as a different availability zones, or in a public cloud if you are in a different availability zone, you can still assure that there is no downtime. The beauty here, right? Think about a massive application like Reliance Jio or the Netflix. You want to upgrade your underlying operating system. Today, you need a downtime. In the Cloud Foundry concept, you can even do each and every layer, whether it is an operating system layer or the operating system in your container image or even your end application itself. Each and everything you can upgrade without the downtime. So we call it as a zero downtime. And this is happening today. And this is a testimony about one of the operations guys. It's there in the Twitter, right? He is telling that, on 200 VMs, there are 30, 40, operating system level upgrades. And I was surprised, he's saying traditional operations will take probably 2 years to do that. So this was, he tweeted in, I think, 1 year back. And so this is just not the Pivotal is doing that. There is a rich ecosystem there. So all the known names are there. And if you see in the platinum and the gold, most of the companies are having their own platforms or products built on top of this technology. Say, for example, GE is Predix, it's built on top of it. Then you will be having SAP's HANA Cloud Platform. It is now in the beta testing. This is built on top of Cloud Foundry. IBM Bloomberg, it's on top of Cloud Foundry. JP Morgan, they are having their platform built on Cloud Foundry. Doesn't stop there. So how we are aligning with the Docker and all those things. So there is something called Open Container Initiative. So it is all about the standardization, right? So Docker is a technology. Cloud Foundry is another technology. But that is not the standard. The standard is that how you are running the container. So we have something called Open Container Initiatives, which is all these companies started together. Docker, Pivotal, Google, and all those things. So they have a specification for container runtime and the container image. So the container runtime, now it is using the Docker RunC as the standard runtime. So even in the Cloud Foundry runtime, it is the same RunC. So if you have a Docker container, you can put it on Cloud Foundry, it will run. So the Cloud Foundry, I think it's the first one who implemented this RunC in production. So that is why using the RunC or the Cloud Foundry's garden container, which is the RunC's implementation, you can deploy a Docker-based application, you can bring a Windows application, you can bring an even any Java application. So another thing we are doing it with the ecosystem is that there's a concept of using services. An application is not sufficient. Okay, I write a Java application. I need to use a messaging queue database. How easy to do that? So in Cloud Foundry terminology, we do that. Just push the application, link with the service, that's all. Nothing else you need to do, that's the platform will. So this concept now the industry is taking out. They started something called Open Service Broker. This is a project launched in December 2016. You can read who are the companies participating. So they try to make this as an accessing services to the applications, make this as an industry or the standardized norm. Another thing, again, so the Kubernetes is popular. There are certain advantages in Kubernetes in certain workloads. So again, you know that the genesis of Kubernetes, it came from Google, right? So there is a project launched by Google in the recently concluded Google Next conference. It's known as the Project Google. The idea is that to bring the same Cloud Foundry experience to run the Kubernetes. If you look at into the Kubernetes today, right, somebody has to get up the VMs and all those things ready so that you can bring the Kubernetes ports on top of it. But what if you bring the same Cloud Foundry experience? So that experience I was talking about, right? You have just one VM, just do one click, the Bosch will take care of everything. If you bring the same experience on top of Kubernetes, right? Bringing and managing the Kubernetes will be much easier. This is one area today there is no other product offering. So that Google and Pivotal jointly working together, this as a one team. And this alpha release is just done in the March 1st week. You can just go there and Google it for that. And right now, it is on a pre-alpha stage. The idea is that, as I said, there is an open service broker concept, right? So if you need a Kubernetes cluster to deploy your containers for whatsoever reasons, right? You just say that, get me a Kubernetes cluster. So the Bosch should be able to do that. So this is the vision. The pre-alpha is already there in the GitHub. You can go and get it, install it, all those things. If you have a GCP cloud, it's very straightforward. Right now that code is available for GCP and OpenStack. And this is not that the GAN, it is really happening. So if you look at into that, you know, so last year was a very fantastic year for us. So, you know, we crossed $270 million business. And if you see the, you know, three of the top retailers, six of the 10 automotive companies, seven of the top 10 US banks, five of the insurance companies, six out of 10 telcos are all, you know, trying to standardize on top of Cloud Foundry because it makes life easier for the developer. And for further reading, I suggest you to, you know, bookmark these things, and there are some interesting things there on the web, so you can download these books. And we are rapidly expanding, and there are some positions open for India, and we are struggling to find the right resources. So if you're interested, go through that, and if you find it's interesting, post your CV. And that's it. Thanks once again. I hope you enjoyed. Any questions?
Take only one or two questions for the interest of time. So we ran out like 10 to 15 minutes. So we'll take two questions. Okay, we'll give a chance to suggest to answer. Okay, two questions.
Yeah.
Listen.
Yes.
Hi. I think you have some major clients like railways or SBI in India, right?
No.
No. Pivotal Labs.
No. So okay. So the Pivotal has Indian Railway as a customer. But not SBI at all. So what is the context of the question? For whom? Customers? So I don't think they have any of those things, but anyway, so we should not talk about those aspects, right? But you know, to address in a general thing, so what we have seen on the industry, see there are two aspects. So there are the primary purpose of having all this technology, right? You have to write the applications and bring that application to production as quickly as possible. Whether you do it on Cloud Foundry or Kubernetes or Docker data center, that doesn't matter. Once that app is on production as quickly as possible and you are able to reduce your operational burdens, then the company makes more money. That is a business aspect. So all these companies, you know, looking at various technologies. For example, even that Kubo, Project Kubo I was talking about, it came, you know, from two of the customers. They have seen, they are using Cloud Foundry in the last 3-4 years. They have seen how easy for to set up a Cloud Foundry ecosystem and run it. So they want the same experience on the Kubernetes. So that is where, you know, Pivotal and the, this is a customer for Google as well as Pivotal. So they are working. So this is very evolving things. So all the technologies are there. So the thing is that how easy we use it.
So, my question is like, could we use any cloud underneath the Cloud Foundry, and what? How do you bill it? You bill it per hour, per day?
So as I said, right? So there was a picture. It's showing that it sits on top of your infrastructure. So you need to have an infrastructure. So to answer the questions, so you can quickly look at into my GCP console. So if you look at into this, there are many VMs the Cloud Foundry created. So your application is running on one of this. This is a kind of a production kind of situation. Okay, there are some around 50-60 VMs are running on GCP. You see all these VMs, right? Some kind of, you know, name. It is created by Bosch. I haven't created any of those things. What I did was I had one, just one VM, and just took the binaries from the pivotal sites, just did some configuration, that's all. So your application, when you push it, it will run here. So when you, when I say when you push the application, right, I'll just show you a simple 1 minute demo. It's easy to understand. So I already connected to a Cloud Foundry environment. Just say we call it as a CF target. So I'm connected to that my GCP environment. As a user, I have an org, whatever it's a concept, it's a, you know, a sandboxed environment. So what I'm having is that two ways you can do that. I have a Java application. Okay, I have a Docker application also. Okay, the same Java application I made it as a Docker. So let me deploy the Docker first. What I do is that I just do a CF push. I created a Docker. I'm not doing any you know, other thing, Kubernetes or anything. What I'll do is that I'll just do a CF push. So doing many things, let's not worry about that. Enough information is available on the internet. You can find it out. This is so easy. You created a Docker image, you want to deploy it. Many things are happening in the backend. You can see it's destroying the containers, creating the containers, then it's trying to start it. So all those things it's doing. So let it do that. Quickly, it's just trying to bring it up. So any other questions?